Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure for me to be here at the IQC. It's my first visit, and I'm really impressed by the diversity of the activities and the number of talented people. I'm really happy to have had a chance to visit the IQC. I'll tell you a little bit about ID Quantique, and Rolf asked me to give a lecture on quantum entrepreneurship. Wasn't too sure what to say, but I thought, I'll tell you a little bit about the past 10 years, because the company was founded 10 years ago in 2001. We're going to celebrate this fall, and try to pick up some elements to give you some things to think about, to consider if you're interested in quantum entrepreneurship. Should also say, Rolf said that ID Quantique is a successful company. It depends what you call success. So it depends also, one thing that is important is when you start is to define what you want to achieve. And if we had want to achieve millions or 100 millions of dollars of revenues, it would not be a success. But our goal when we started the company was to really be there for the long term and try to go step by step and bring quantum technologies to the market. And so in that sense, we're quite happy of what we've achieved. But we still know that the road is still long and difficult, and every year is still a challenge for the company. But I'll tell you that during this lecture. Maybe as a start, just we're in Geneva. I know that on Lake Erie, I know there's a Geneva on the lake, but it's a different Geneva. It's Geneva, Switzerland, in the center of Europe, and we're spin off from the University of Geneva. A lot of the developments were done there before we started the company, and Geneva is a good place to do, we think, quantum cryptography. Geneva is a canton, so like a province in Switzerland, and it has a flag as a canton, and that's the flag of Geneva. So if you look, you see a key, so it must be a good place to do quantum cryptography, quantum key distribution. You also see that there's a sun on top of the coat of arms, and so it's good about doing quantum optics because they know about light. And the motto of Geneva is post tenebras lux, so after darkness comes the light. You could say after the darkness of classical crypto comes the light of quantum crypto. So that we think it's a good place. Also, one thing that you could be interested of, and I'll briefly mention, is that we organize every year in January in Switzerland a winter school on practical quantum cryptography. I know that you have a summer school on quantum cryptography here in Waterloo. In this particular course that we organize, and the fourth edition will take place in January of 2012, we really focus on applied on practical problems, applications, and also operating a quantum cryptography system. And we have lectures by keynote speakers like Nicolas Gisin, Renato Renner, Vadim Makarov also comes. And we've had so far over 45 participants, different countries, and industry, academia. It's also a good place to network. So if any of you are interested, you could visit our website and find more information about this. Okay, so I'll start now looking 10 years back. And I've told you we're a spin-off from the University of Geneva, from the group of Nicolas Gisin. And at the time, Nicolas' group had three areas of activities. And I remember he was always presenting them as going from very applied to fundamental research. And so optical sensors, optical fiber metrology he was also doing, and quantum cryptography was kind of the more basic research aspect of Nicolas' work. And I must say that something that was interesting in his group is that there was a lot of entrepreneurial spirit, because he had already created a company in, I think, 94, called Gap Optique SA, GAPS being Group of Applied Physics, doing optical fiber instrumentation, and the company had been then sold after 2 years to a company called EXFO. Some of you may know EXFO because they do optical fiber measurement devices you may have in the lab. And so when I got there, there was a lot of entrepreneurial spirit. I started my PhD in 97. There was still this spirit from this company. I must say I picked the group of Nicolas Gisin not for the research, but because of his link with industry because of this. At the time in Switzerland, it was really difficult to find people doing research but interested in spin-offs. And that's what drew me there. Turned out to be an interesting choice in terms of research, but I must say I was not aware of the quality of the research they were doing as a young PhD student. I really went there for this company, which has already closed at the time. So it was kind of too bad, but the spirit was still there. And so that was that's probably something that motivated me also to look more into, after doing some research, at commercializing also some results. So in 2001, what did we have? Well, you know, we'd done research on quantum cryptography, and here you see a picture of a quantum cryptography system in 1998, optical fiber based, so it was kind of, didn't look too commercial. But so over the next 3 years, we really tried to do a nice prototype, to put everything in a box, to automate the operation, start doing some software. And a quite important development was that we were able to go from liquid nitrogen-cooled single-photon detectors, which was what was used in 98, to detectors that were cooled using Peltier cooling. So it was much easier then to do a nice package, much more practical in terms of not having to put liquid nitrogen every day or every week. And so we thought, now maybe the technology is mature enough to try to see if there are applications for this technology. And so the idea, you all know about how it works, cryptography. The idea is that you need a secret key to secure information. How do you exchange the key? The classical way is using public key cryptography, where the encryption key is encrypted using public key cryptography. So one key is used to encrypt, the other key is used to decrypt. And because of this asymmetry, you don't have the key exchange problem, but you have some vulnerabilities to theoretical progress, increase in computing power, and quantum computing. And so what really we're doing, at the time we were doing, what quantum cryptography is about, key distribution, and so we had this system, and thought there would be some potential. We were also, so the company was founded by four people in October of 2001. This is a picture that was taken when we went to the place to do the incorporation of the notary to do the incorporation of the company. And as you can see, the company was founded by four people. Two of them are university professors. They were, and they still are, Professor Gisin and Professor Spinden. So they knew at the time that they didn't want to leave the university. They had a good position. But they were interested in trying to find applications. And so everything was basically people that were going to do the work was Olivier Guinard, an electronic engineer, and myself. And so we left the university and started working on different products. So we were quite motivated. And at the time, there were some nice articles that came out. I picked one from The Economist, uncrackable beams of light. Quantum cryptography is finally going commercial. So we're motivated by this publicity that we're getting. But we didn't really know what we were going to do with the technology. We kind of knew that this looked nice as a physicist prototype, but this was not something that could be used as a product by network engineers that wanted to secure a network. So we knew that there was work to do. But we thought, there's something, some potential. And so in a sense, what you could really say is that we had a vision for what to do with this technology, but still not a very clear vision. We knew that we needed to research a bit more. So now, when you start a company, typically we need to fund the company. You need to find resources to do to grow your company. And that's typically the cycle that you go through in the textbook startup approach, where you first invest some money, so founder's capital. Then you call your family and your friends and ask to help. Then, so that's the three Fs, and they forgot one, actually, because normally you say the four Fs invest in a company: founders, family, friends, and fools. But I guess it's not politically correct to mention them here. But then you need to find some more professional investors, typically angel investors or early stage venture capitalists, people that will give you money but expect a return for this money. Then you go normally to a full-fledged venture capital fund and then look for expansion capital. So we were here and we needed to do the first step. And there was only one employee, as you can see, because at the time we had the possibility to keep one person on the payroll of the university, which was quite good. And so that was me, and I would just work at night on the company and the development, because I was not useful, because the useful person is not the physicist, it's the engineer that does the development. As a physicist, I was kind of useless to do the development, so I stayed at the university, did a little bit of research, and worked at night for the company. And in Switzerland, when you start a company, you need to invest about 100,000 Swiss francs, and it's about 100,000 Canadian dollars. It's about 1-to-1. So you need to invest. There's a kind of a barrier, and we invested this amount. We were four people, you know, physicists divided by four. Everyone invested a quarter of this amount, and we started, and that was enough to start for a year. You know, had a little bit of capital. What we did was immediately to focus on developing, on generating some revenues, because immediately we knew that if we wanted to go to the next step, family and friends, we didn't have good enough friends or wealthy enough family, and we had to skip this approach. So what we basically had to do is to find revenues for the company from the very beginning. And of course, at the time, quantum cryptography was our vision, but we knew that it would be take some time before we could generate revenues. So we went to something else, and we basically developed, took out part of the technology, the receiver of the quantum cryptography system, and developed a single photon detector for typically research customers. And as a first step, and I think it was also a good move in the sense that it forced us to industrialize this part of the technology, which was the most difficult one at the time in quantum cryptography. So then to have physicists play with this kind of devices was a good test for the reliability of the technology. So it also served us in that respect. Then we also, another type of revenue was to also develop a simple quantum random number generator. Because that's something that was needed for quantum cryptography anyway, and we thought there could be some interesting applications for this product. So we put together a simple USB device that you can see here, and the principle is sending single photons, or attenuated laser pulses, I should say, on a 50-50 mirror, and then with two detectors, we would produce a stream of random bits. It was actually not done in free space, but optical fiber, and we actually had a single detector, but did time multiplexing to reduce the cost. So we developed that, partly with the university, and started selling a few of these devices. So we had a small revenue base, and then we still needed a little bit more revenues. And in Europe, I don't know about the situation in Canada, but in Europe there's the possibility to get research funding from the European Union. It has a research program called the Framework Program, and you can participate in research projects, get a little bit of funding. And in Switzerland, it's the only way to get funding for a company. Swiss government is very rigorous in not supporting the economy. The economy should be self-sustaining, and so there's really no possibility to get support from the government. But European Union's, even though Switzerland is not in the EU, but we still get support from the EU. I should say that, for example, I don't know about Canada, but in the US, there are schemes that are very, that I would dream of, these so-called SBIR, Small Business Initiative Research, which would be very useful, because it's the instruments where really there's research money going into the company, and the company can then do research, develop products based on this, and that's really useful when starting a company. One of the advantages of the US approach is that a single company can apply with a project, whereas in Europe you have to be part of a big consortium with universities and everything, and you get a little bit, you just get on the train with them and can get a little bit of funding. And another thing that we did for a little while was to look for awards. And awards are also kind of an alternative way to get some funding. Again, I don't know about the situation in Canada, but in Switzerland you can get awards worth of, up to 100,000 Swiss francs. And at the time it was fairly easy, because there were not a lot of startups in Europe. It was just after the internet bubble. There was all this fuss about startups, but in Europe, a lot of people were saying we need more startups. So if you started a company, you would immediately get some awards, and that was quite easy, and that really helped us also at the time. I should say also that what I'm saying here was also linked to the fact that in 2001 was after the internet bubble exploded, And there was really no other type of funding available. The venture capitalists were not willing to take risk. It was a very difficult time. So we really had to go for these approaches. So maybe one lesson here is when you come with very early stage technology, you could go and try to find VCs, but you may end up wasting a lot of time because you're not mainstream enough and it's really too early stage. So a lesson could be to consider also alternative funding approaches such as revenues, awards, and try to keep costs as low as possible, of course. So now, in 2004, went to the next step. So we had about approximately a little bit more than 2 years of operation, had revenues. We had also spent this time to define what we wanted to do with quantum cryptography technology, where it should be applied, what would be the use case, so what we would target if we were able to develop a product. Because I should say that during the first phase of the company, we really didn't have the resources to work on the development of the QKD device. We're really, doing detector stuff, random number generator stuff. But in parallel, so we put together a business plan and managed in early 2004 to raise one round of funding of 1 million euro from an early stage VC. Really, it was in between an angel investor and early stage VC. An angel investor being an individual, interested in supporting businesses, and an early stage VC being a more institutionalized form of this. But it was really in between the two, and we got 1 million euro, which allowed us to start developing the QKD technology. I have a slide with the title Hockey Stick, and I don't know why there's a hockey stick here, but there's also a hockey stick in entrepreneurship. And when you want to get some funding from an investor, basically you have to come up with a curve. Typically the time is on the horizontal axis, and then you put revenues, cash, number of users, whatever, on the vertical axis, a measure of success. Typically you want to go, you're here because you have a project, you're at the beginning, you have no revenues, no users, nothing, but you believe that there's a lot of potential and you think that if you have time and resources to go, you can go up there. And then you need to kind of draw a line to say how you're going to do this. And so, of course, one approach is to say, well, I'll go, gradually, linearly up there. But that's not very plausible because that would be an approach where you don't need an investor because you could do a little business and you reinvest the profits and then you grow like this. That would be the organic growth model. If you can do this, you don't need an investor. So an investor would not be interested. Same thing for this. This is not very credible to say, we'll grow. And so the real approach that you can discuss with an investor is a hockey stick. I need a lot of money, I need time, I'll develop something, but then there'll be a lot of value coming out of it. So you always have some kind of hockey stick curve in your business plan. Usually it shifts after time. So maybe you put 2,000 and then 3 years later you're at the same stage, but it's still a hockey stick. But that it's the shape that's important, I guess. And it's important to understand also why investors will invest money in your project. And why would someone invest in a company? Well, basically people who have money, they have the choice. They could go to the stock market. And if you look at historical market returns for stock, it's been 8%. So that's really looking back 50 years or so. The past few years are not so good, I must say. But historical returns, if you average over a long time, 8%. So if you invest $1 today, and you're a bit lucky, you have $2 in 10 years. And if someone wants to invest in a small company, there's a more risk than in the stock market. I mean, because there's market risk, people risk, technology is not proven, so there's high risk, but also they would expect higher return. And so typically, in venture capital, people will invest with a time horizon of 5 to 10 years. 10 years would be a little bit long. They would expect to make some money after 5 years. And they know that there is a high failure rate because it's high risk, so maybe 80% failure rate. And so in order to compensate this, and if you want to beat this 8% return, you see by doing a little calculation that you need to get a return of like 10 times. On the project that work have to be highly successful. You can't go to a VC and say, you know, I'll grow by 8% per year because of the risk. You have higher risk than an established company, so you need to promise a higher return. And that's really something important to understand. If you don't do this, then they won't listen to you because you're not interesting. So the question is really, can you offer this kind of return? You know, if you ask for 1 million, you must promise 10 million in 5 years' time. So, and that's really important to understand. And you must realize also that you have to promise this, and so you have to believe it, because if you promise something you don't believe, it's difficult. You get in tough situations.
Excuse me, just a question here. But the 10 million, you don't have to give the investor, right? It's more like that's the value.
It's the value of the company, but the investor will want to go out. So there will need to be what they call a liquidity event. They need to sell the company or go to the stock market in this time horizon, because otherwise they can't get their money out. They don't want to leave the money in your company because they have to give it back to people that have invested in their fund. So they really also need to plan an exit strategy, what they call, which with a liquidity event. And basically, when you sign a contract with a venture capitalist, you give away your company, because you have to give them all the rights to actually do this liquidity event. So for example, if they decide to sell, you have to sell. And they have drag-along clauses that they can force you to sell at the same price as they do when they want to. Because, you know, if let's say they have, let's say they have 50% of the company and you keep 50%, then someone that is interested in buying the company might not be interested in getting only 50%. Maybe they want the whole company. So in order to get maximum flexibility, the VC will insist in having the possibility to take you along and force you to sell. So you really lose control of the company once you have a VC in. But you know, if there's potential and you're ready to play the game, that's one approach. And then, so if you get an investor, convince an investor, then, you know, it's nice. So now you can draw another curve where you can put the cash that you have in the bank. And typically you have a curve like this. You have a lot of cash, so it's nice, you can invest, hire a few people, buy some equipment, but cash will go down. You have a burn rate and go down faster than you want. And then you have two possibilities when you reach, get close to zero, is that first to get another investment round, and so new injection of cash in order to continue developing the company, and that's perfectly okay. They're companies, in certain cases, you want to do this because you want to give away, you know, just the right amount of the company at the right time to get the right amount of money, so that then you can do a first step and increase the value of the company so that you can get again money at a better value later. So it depends. And that, you know, I think that's the approach that Magic has taken. They've had a number of rounds of investment and have done that. That's one possibility. The other possibility is to try to, you know, to just avoid the ground and do a touch and go, in a sense, and have revenues early enough to start helping you keep your cash level. Maybe not, you know, what you want is you don't want to grow the cash, but you want to keep it at a level that is sufficient for you to run the company. The company is not going to become a bank, so the goal of the company is not to hold cash, to reinvest part of the profits in order to continue to grow the company. So so we were in 2004, we've raised, so we were at this point here, so we had promised a nice hockey stick and we were at this point, we had some cash, and our strategy, and which we had agreed with the VC, was to try to go for the blue approach and not the red approach. So to try to use just one round in order to come with the first generation of QKD product and to be some, if possible, profitable, or at least to be able to sustain the company. And so what we first did was to try to improve this product to generate some revenues, because that was a much shorter term development project. So we improve this generator. At the time, this device was sold $10,000, more or less. And we sold a few, but that was way too expensive for the market. And we kind of got a figure, of, you know, an order of magnitude, which was to say should be the same price as a server, because it will run in a server. Servers, $1,000, $2,000. So it should not be much more expensive than the server, because it's a peripheral that you insert, need to insert in a server. So we aimed at reducing the cost of the generator, and we developed a component much more miniaturized and much cheaper to manufacture, but still the same principle, and derived it in multiple products, some boards to put in a server, some USB generator. The price is about from $1,000 to $3,000, so we managed to reach this this goal. And we also realized that the quantumness of the product was important, but it was just one little thing to generate interest. But it's not, people don't want quantum products, they want solutions to their problems. And one problem is to get random number random numbers. That's the problem they have, and they want to know that they could get good random numbers. So it's important to get certification of the device. And so we had to have it certified by, we've done several certifications, but one of them was by the Swiss equivalent of NIST, the Metrology Institute of Switzerland, which basically tested did some statistical test on the output of the generator and gave us a stamp saying it's good. And that was an important step. And also, you know, you need to, people will need to use it. So the software side is also important. What can you use the generator with? What platforms and things like this? So I would say the quantumness was important, but these other elements are also very important in a product if you want to provide a solution and not a technology, which is not the goal of a company. Now, you know, after doing that, we had our quantum key distribution, and then we were in the position to start developing a real system for quantum cryptography. And so the goal, we wanted to go from this system, university prototype, to a system, a big, you know, something looking strong, and we felt it had to be black for security, so we made a black box, and to go beyond really having just the QKD part. You know, the QKD layer is the optical quantum optics part. But there's really, what we needed to do is also add administration capabilities, because that's what's important for the users. And also then we went around and asked people in the crypto industry and asked them, you know, with such a technology to do key distribution, could it be used with standard encryption products so that we interface them, we pass keys to your encryptors, and then you can just use the keys and do the encryption. And the answer was always, no. We don't want to get keys from outside. It's insecure. A key must remain in a secure enclosure, secure perimeter. So everything has to be in one box, black box if possible. So we also had to develop the encryption in the same box with the keys being passed to the QKD. So we had a first box. We had to learn about encryption, had our first box doing a link encryption. So really the idea was to have two boxes connected to each other. One link for the key distribution, the other link for the data being encrypted with the keys, and we had a first prototype. The optical system, just that will be the only scientific slide today, I guess, but just to mention that we're specialized in fiber-based systems and weak laser pulses, and we use an approach called self-compensating or plug-and-play, where instead of sending photons from Alice to Bob, they're actually sent from Bob first, go to Alice, and they're reflected back to Bob. And so on this slide, you have Bob here with the laser producing the pulses, then an interferometer. We do phase coding, but on the way to Alice, nothing happens. So you have two pulses that travel here, and then they get to Alice, and they're reflected, and then Alice would modulate the phase of one of the two pulses with respect to the other, and then the pulse will be attenuated to the single photon level or 0.1, whatever value, and then travels back and goes to the interferometer. So basically, we have interference between the pulse taking the long arm, going to Alice, coming back, and then short arm, and interference from short arm to Alice, and then long arm, interference here, and depending on the phase values, we get 0, 1, values. And one thing that we also did was to use a Faraday mirror. so to compensate all the polarization modifications. So that, you know, if we launched, that's the point, on the Poincaré sphere, if we launched a polarization state from Bob, then there would be some evolution in the fiber, which is depends on the environmental condition. But then the Faraday mirror rotates the polarization by 45 degrees. You get a reflection, which is the mirror itself. Then a second, you pass again in the Faraday rotator, which rotates again by 45 degrees, and you're now orthogonal. So that all the perturbation in the fiber are compensated, and the pulse comes back exactly orthogonal to what it was when it left Bob. So you get very, you get self-compensating, or what we call plug and play. And I should say that this approach had been patented at the time. It was invented at the University of Geneva by Nicolas Gisin and Hugo Zbinden, and with funding from the telecom company of Switzerland called Swisscom. And Swisscom had applied for a patent because they needed a patent. And at the time, in the mid-90s, really in European universities, no one cared about patents. So the university gave away all the rights. And so the patent was filed by Swisscom. They didn't do anything with it. So when we started the company, we got a non-exclusive license from the Swisscom. And the reason we got a non-exclusive, we wanted, of course, an exclusive license. But Magic had also contacted Swisscom and asked for a license. And Swisscom trusted an American startup more than a Swiss startup, which is kind of a shame. So they said, you know, you guys in Geneva, you're nice, you're our friends, but we don't trust you. You won't be able to maximize the potential of this patent. So we'll give you a non-exclusive license, but we also give one to Magic. So that's how we started. When we got the investor, the investor was interested in us having really some kind of strong intellectual property. So we had to go back to Swisscom and negotiate an exclusive license. And we really went back to them and said, if you give us an exclusive license, we can get 1 million euro. So, you know, help us. And they listened to that and changed the agreement. So this is to say that when you look for an investor, you have to give them something tangible. And I know a patent is not very tangible, but it's more tangible than your ideas and your projection and your hockey stick. And so it's important to have something in your hands if you want to go that road. So now, then, we ran into a problem that we did not expect at all. And this, you know, we're thinking everybody that has sensitive data is encrypting these data anyway. So we're just coming with an additional level of security. But what we realized is that there was no encryption in place in most cases, and that optical fibers were considered as secure. Because basically, the switch from copper cables to fibers for long-distance communications took place in the early 90s. And there was the misconception that, you know, a cable is insecure because you can put a probe close to the cable. There's some evanescent field. You can measure what's going through the cable. So you can intercept very easily data on a cable. And then people thought that since in an optical fiber, the light is confined in the core, there's no evanescent field outside of the glass of the optical fiber, then there is no possibility to eavesdrop on an optical fiber without cutting the fiber. And if you cut the fiber, there's an alarm, people will detect something. So basically, an optical fiber is security. If you have an optical fiber, you don't need to encrypt. That was a big surprise. We didn't expect that at all. And then also we heard that on an optical fiber, the bit rate is so high, you know, gigabit, maybe 10 gigabit, that it's impossible to eavesdrop, which is a bit silly for me also, because if you can send data at a certain rate and receive data at another rate, an eavesdropper can also do the same thing and intercept traffic. So it was a bit silly. And also, you know, in fibers, people do wavelength division multiplexing, different colors of light for different channels. That also was considered as something offering security, which is a bit strange. But as physicists, we were a bit surprised, and we thought, you know, if you have an optical fiber, light is guided in the fiber. If you bend the fiber, some light will go out. And you can intercept light by just bending an optical fiber and collecting the light. And there are actually small devices like this where you have a little reel. The optical fiber comes here and is bent. There's a prism that collects the light, which goes in this fiber. Quite a bit of insertion loss, 3 dB, and 10 dB coupling efficiency, so it's not a very highly efficient device, but you can clip it on the fiber and really get all the light out. And so we set up a small demo unit, a small suitcase, with the coupling device, a little bit of transmission devices, and we could go do demonstration to people, say, you know, you should look at your optical fibers because they're not secure, and with a few hundred euros, you can buy all this equipment in order to attack an optical fiber. Then the answer we got is, okay, maybe you're right, but an optical fiber, it's under the ground, it's protected. How could someone access the optical fiber? No problem, you know, we're not worried at all. And then, so you have to think a little bit about an optical fiber, and it's made in reels, and so you have a cable, hundreds of fibers, typically in a cable, and it's put on the reel so that a truck can bring it on the road and to install it. And the reel cannot, you know, transport more than 1 or 2 kilometers of fiber. Otherwise, it would be way too big. So if you have a long stretch, you always have splices or fusion splices every 1 or 2 kilometers. And these are done in fusion chambers, in splice chambers, where optical fiber cables come out here, and then they go to these splice chambers where actually you have the bare fibers, which are fusion spliced and available. If you open one of these, you see the fibers here, and you see the place where the splicers are put, and you could really clip on a coupler here and access all the data. And so we tried to explain this, and then we needed to be a little bit more convincing and to show show people that it's actually possible to access these devices. So we made a little movie on how you can find an optical fiber. And so what we did was to buy a hard hat. This is our R&D manager. You have to find the right manhole. This is for the traffic lights in Geneva. This is the Swisscom, so telecom things. This is another telecom company. So you find the manhole. And then we bought some equipment, very basic equipment. So, you know, a hard hat and a yellow jacket and decided to go see if we could find. So this is in front of a big international company selling cigarettes. And we're trying to open the manhole. We needed a key, but after a few minutes, the receptionist came and said, oh, can I help you? Shall I go get the key for you guys? And unfortunately, my colleague preferred to get her phone number rather instead of the key. But then, so we went somewhere else. We continued looking around. Here, you know, you can lift it. This was, I think, maybe the electricity. So not so interesting. We looked around, tried a few manholes in the area, and that's, you know, a building where there could be offices. We didn't go too close to our customers because we didn't want to piss them off. So this is a post office. But then he found one that was interesting, decided to cordon off the area, ask someone to move a motorbike, and then started pretending he was doing construction work. This was mid-afternoon in the banking district in Geneva. And you could imagine, you know, coming with a van and setting up a van, taking out some equipment. And no one is going to come and ask you questions. And then he went in, everything, found an optical fiber cable down there, and took out the equipment. And again, you put a van here, and you could do all this very quietly. And then, so if you'll see, it's almost the end, but you'll see inside that you can see the optical fiber cable. We'll show you this. So that's the cable is here, and you can, if you can, we don't want to show this, but that's the name of the company using the optical fiber. So it's a bit strange, but they even labeled the cables with the company. So really, you know, it's important to secure information. And I should say that yesterday when we went for lunch with Rolf and Thomas, I saw people in Waterloo taking out one of these. And so it looks fairly easy to do the same thing in Waterloo, so if you want to try. Then what this told us is that there would be some education to do on the market, also on the concept of encryption. And we also, at this point, that's what we started doing. And at this point, we also realized that this was not really our specialty. So, you know, we were really quantum optics guys. We would learn a little bit about the admin, the software admin, but this was not our specialty, especially if you want to do very high-speed crypto, and if you want to have certification also. And so we decided to change strategy and to collaborate with another company specializing in classical crypto. So what we did now is to develop a solution which is separate, consists of two boxes. One box doing encryption and specialized for encryption. And it's a collaboration with an Australian company called Senetas. They have all the certification that you want. Really, they've been on the market for 10 years. And then quantum key distribution as our specialty, as a separate device that acts as a key server, in a sense, or distributed random number generator, providing keys to these encryptors. So the complete solution looks like this. And we can actually stack even more encryptors, up to 12 encryptors, so that one QKD device can be mutualized or used by several encryptors to reduce the cost, the premium of quantum cryptography. And so here, one lesson is also to question the view of incumbent players, because when we ask people, that was our idea at the beginning. And so we asked some companies in classical crypto, and they all said, no, that you can't do that because it's not secure. The key should not go out. Of course, we encrypt the keys on the local link between the QKD box and the encryptor, and that's considered now as perfectly acceptable. So it's good to listen to people that are already in the market, but sometimes you also need to question that a little bit. So now, so that was until, we're at this phase, that was 2004 to 2006-07, we were cash going down, and then we're getting close to this, to the point where we didn't have any cash left, and we needed to see what would be the next step. And we decided not to go for venture capital because of the potential of the market was too difficult to explain, and to achieve this 10-time ratio was difficult to really convince of ourselves first and an investor also of this. So we decided to change the model and to focus on revenues even more, invest even more in revenues, and R&D funding also continued this. And so we really now developed our sales force at this point with more people involved in sales and marketing. And also we formalized the separation in three business units of the different activities: scientific instrumentation, random number generator, and network encryption. And so we started with just one detector, this device which covers the near infrared from 1 micron to 1.6 micron. We develop other detectors for the visible range, silicon-based detectors, a detector for 1064, and also some lasers. Just to say, we invested in, we grew this part of the business because it was maybe not a high potential. No one, I think, no venture capitalist would invest in a scientific instrument business because it's the potential return is too low, but it's a great way to get short-term revenues, and that's what we decided to optimize. Just to mention that we have a new detector that just came out and that's being tested by Thomas and his group, and so that's something we continue to, we think it's very important, and it's also very aligned with our quantum cryptography strategy because it's an enabling technology for quantum cryptography. The random number generator, so we had launched this new generation of products, smaller products, and we were targeting security applications, but we found another application that we had not expected at all, which is the online gaming market. Take a site that's called BetCruise, where you can do casino, poker, and the new trend now is to play online, so you have a server somewhere in a tax-friendly country, Malta, Gibraltar, Isle of Man, nice places. And the server runs the game and needs randomness to shuffle cards or to play roulette and things like this. And if you go on this website, you can see at the bottom that randomness by ID Quantique, they were nice enough to do this. It's not, we didn't ask for this, but they thought it'd be a good idea to do this. And on some of these websites, they have a, I don't know if we can see here, maybe not, but they often have a menu where you can get information on the fact that it's fair gaming, so that you don't get cheated if you play this game with them. And if you look, sometimes they say, well, we use a quantum random number generator to guarantee fair gaming. Sometimes we get an email by someone saying, oh, I've been playing for 2 weeks on this website. They say they use your generator. I've lost every time, so I don't believe it. So it's a bit difficult because, first of all, how can we be sure that they use our our random number generator. And secondly, if I wanted to influence the games, if I wanted to do an unfair gaming, you do it at the software level, the post-processing level, and not at the random number generator level. So that's one thing. And another application that's also a little bit funny is someone came up with the idea of doing a website called cheapuniverses.com. And it's an iPhone app, $2, I think. It's called a universe splitter. And so you can, in this app, you can type, you say, in one universe, I will now take a chance. In the other one, I will now play it safe. And it's they have a random number generator, Quantis, and whenever there's a choice that's made, they connect to the server, and they take a random number and decide this, and they say that it splits a universe. And then after a few things, you can see in which universe you are. You know, you start here, and then you go to a different universe. So it's kind of a silly application, but funny for physicists. Okay. And that was the second activity, and quantum cryptography with some real applications now that started in 2007. The first application, to my knowledge, the first real application of quantum cryptography was that done for the elections in Geneva. Of course, I think Magic said that they'd done this before, but at least it was publicized in October of 2007. And the idea was to secure a link between the place where the ballots are counted in Geneva and the data center. Because the way it works is that in Geneva you can vote by mail, so paper mail, or you can go to polling stations. But then all the paper votes are sent to a central vote counting station with terminals and people counting the ballots. And each ballot is counted at least twice by two groups of people. So there's a kind of a progress for the ballots. And so the terminals are connected to a mainframe computers that run the application for doing the vote counting. So there's kind of a critical link here for security, where you don't really want confidentiality, but you want integrity. You want to be sure that no one can really connect on the link and change the values of the votes counted. And so we can manage to convince the IT department of the Geneva government to use quantum cryptography for this. It took us 5 years, I think, of discussions, because really when we started the company, we immediately went to them, told them that could be a good application. And so they decided in 2007, but then they told us, oh, but it must be running in 4 days. So, you know, 5 years, but then 4 days to install the thing was really kind of an interesting thing. But the good thing is that we were ready. And so we set up the system, and it was used in October 2007. And it's been used 5 times so far, because every time there's an election, it's used. So it's installed there. It runs all the time. But it's used for about a month for every election, about, you know, 1 month of testing of the infrastructure, and then 24 hours of vote counting. So, and it's still in use right now. And, you know, maybe quantum cryptography might be a little bit overkill here, because you don't really need long-term data security. But encryption, I think it's very reasonable to put encryption on such a link. They didn't have any encryption. So I think they made a right choice. It was good also for PR reasons to do it with quantum cryptography. But I wouldn't say that it's a completely unreasonable application of quantum cryptography. Now, one thing. You're probably mostly physicist here. And I'll say that now what I'll show you is the one slide about quantum physics that I have in my commercial presentation when I go see customers. You know, I have a presentation of about 25, 30 slides normally, and there's one slide about quantum physics. It's the only slide I have. You know, just to explain principle communication, like tennis balls, and a photon is like a soap bubble. So you replace the tennis ball by a soap bubble. It's fragile if someone intercepts. What I want to say here is that you really don't need to talk about physics if you try to sell something about quantum cryptography. Because you again, people are not interested in quantum technology. They want a solution. You think, okay, I need a strong key. So there's a new approach to distribute a key. And they're usually convinced about the value of the technology. And that's thanks to you all and to the people that do the dissemination work in the back. Because, you know, every time there's an article in the press, in the general press or something, about quantum cryptography, then people will read about it. And when they look at a solution, they don't need to be convinced. They don't want to understand it. They've read about it. They know that there are serious people that research it. And what they want to know is about the details of the solution, the price, things like this. And so if any of you tries to set up a company in this area, please forget that, you know, physics is very exciting, but you shouldn't do it for the physics, but to bring solutions to people. Another deployment that is more recent and that I wanted to mention just to show you also that it's fairly mature, it's something that we've done with Siemens IT Solutions in the Netherlands, so it's the IT division of Siemens, and we've secured a communication between two data centers, one in The Hague and the other one in Zoetermeer, and the configuration, they had six links to secure, so there were six pairs of encryptors and one QKD system. And here you see the advantage of the approach of separating encryptors and QKD is that this device can pass keys to all encryptors in pairs, one dark fiber for the quantum channel, and then one other fiber where they multiplex all the communications in wavelengths division multiplexing. And you see here the picture, the six encryptors and the QKD device. And so that's kind of the typical deployments that we look for. Deployments with lots of links in parallel, so high speed, because there would be optical fiber, and QKD makes a lot of sense in these applications. Now, one thing I must mention, you know, the principle of QKD, if you read it in scientific papers, is you need a key, you want to do one-time pad, you know, one bit of key for each bit of data, and you need to distribute a secure key. That's not what we do in the encryptors because the system is too slow. It produces about 1,000 bits per second over 25 kilometers. So what we do instead here is we use AES, which is the standard of symmetric encryption. It stands for the Advanced Encryption Standard, which uses keys of 256 bits. And we do this so we pass keys to these encryptors that do AES encryption. And the key is changed once per minute. And that's limited not by QKD, but by the encryptors themselves. They can't go faster than this for the key refresh. So that's the first thing, AES encryption and not one-time pad. And the second thing is that we don't do only quantum key distribution, but we also do public key cryptography in parallel. So we really exchange two keys in parallel. And we then what we do is that the actual secret key is a function of the mixing of the conventional key and the quantum key. And the idea of doing this, and so you do this mixing in a way that you're sure that the key that you produce is as strong as the strongest of the two keys. And the reason, one of the reasons to do this is with public key cryptography, it's possible to certify a product because there exist standards, and so someone, a certification lab can go through the standard, can see if particular implementation matches the standard, you can get a stamp and say, okay, this is a certified solution. With quantum key distribution, it's not the case yet. And that's one of the problems. And by doing this combination, we ensure that the whole solution, even if it uses quantum key distribution, remains certified because quantum key distribution cannot weaken the solution in a sense. And so someone can make a choice, an employee in a bank can decide to deploy quantum key distribution without taking a big risk, because it'll know that at least it has the security of classical crypto. It'll have the certificate, it can show his boss if there's a problem, he can cover his choice. And it's just a financial risk that he's taking by deploying quantum key distribution, because it may cost a bit more, but if he has the budget, that's okay. That was also a very important step to ensure the acceptability of quantum key distribution. And another thing is that we stop talking about absolute security because, you know, that's something, you saw this in the early press release, that's something that it really doesn't make sense to talk about absolute security because, first of all, you know, can you get absolute security? You always have assumptions, especially in implementations. And then also security is a chain. And so does it make sense to have something with absolute security if other links are weaker? So what's important now is really to talk about the fact that with quantum cryptography, your key will always remain as secure as it is today. You know, if it's secure today, it will remain secure in the future. And that's a feature that you don't have with classical cryptography. And it's very important for applications where you need long-term data confidentiality. And so that's what we pitch now, and we don't talk, absolutely avoid absolute security. And we also learned that, you know, QKD will not replace conventional technology, but complement it. And that's kind of obvious. We kind of knew this from the beginning, but it took us some time to realize and to clarify also our messages. And I think that one of the problems the community has had is that with claims like absolute security, we really pissed off the classical cryptographer guys who said, you guys don't know about security. How can you talk about absolute security? And they stopped. They didn't get interested in quantum cryptography. And that's too bad. And now it's important to try to build bridges between the two communities in order to foster adoption of this technology. Now there are some roadblocks for wider market acceptance, and I want to share a few with you just to tell you a little bit where we see difficulties now in growing the market. It's growing, we have applications, but still it's going slow. One of the things is that first, the limited number of use cases. You know, the only application now for QKD is link encryption. You have a link to two sites, and you need highly secure communication between the two sites. It's one application, but it's a fairly limited type of application. So if people could find other applications, that would certainly help developing the market. Also, three other problems: a clear expression of the return on investment. I'll discuss this a bit more. Total cost of ownership, also I'll discuss a bit more, and some deployment difficulties. And so we'll look at these now. And the return on investment, you know, as I've said, the idea that QKD offers keys that are long secure for the long term. But we combine them with AES 256. Now the problem is, how can you quantify the benefit in dollars or in euros of adding QKD? You know, the cost can be estimated, but what does it bring if someone decides to deploy QKD? What will be the return on investment? And this is difficult to formalize. The other thing is that the number of applications that require long-term data confidentiality, you know, more than 5 years, let's say, is relatively limited. Because a lot of secrets in this world don't need to remain secret for that long. My credit card number is maybe valid for 2 years, and after 2 years, if it's lost, I don't really care. And so the current situation is that if you have the time, if you have someone willing to explain, they can understand the benefits of QKD, but it takes a long time. Also, people know that black swans exist. That there can be events with very low probability can occur. And that comes out a little bit of the financial crisis where people, no one expected it to happen. And it taught people a few things. But it requires education of the market. And so it's difficult to accelerate really the market development for a small company like us. So certainly the also dissemination efforts done at institutes such as the IQC are very useful for us. Also, it'd be important to have collaboration with conventional cryptography groups to better formalize the benefit of QKD and the return on investment. Another thing is the total cost of ownership. And when we started the company, we thought, this I would not say anymore, huh? But we thought, oh, absolute security has no price. You can sell it at any price. And also that for a bank, a few hundred thousand euros is negligible in an IT budget. And that's not true at all, actually. Every cost has to be justified. And I'll show you a little bit that security is actually hard to sell. And there are three reasons why it's hard to sell. So in a sense, you know, quantum cryptography is an interesting business, but it's probably one of the most difficult ones. First of all, it requires trust. And as a small company, that's something that it's difficult to have. You don't have a track record. You're considered as small. You could go bankrupt, and so it's really difficult to get trust as a small company. In the security business, normally when you start a company, you sell a product to one customer, you use it as a reference, and this customer says, "Oh, this product is so great that I could do this and this and this," and then you can go see other customers. In security, it's impossible because no one wants to talk about what they use in practice. Because there's the fear that if you mention what kind of security technology you use, the day if it gets broken, then you are immediately vulnerable to an attack. So obscuring what you use is also considered as good practices in security. So you can never use references, which is one of the difficulties also for a small company. And the other thing is that people don't like to spend money for security. You know, people don't like to pay for insurances. And there's actually some science, scientific theory behind this. Because there's something, you know, until the late 70s, there was, in economy, people considered the human being as a rational economic man. You know, a human being makes decision, economic decision on a rational basis, looking at the utility of the different choices and making a rational choice. And in the late 70s, some people started to question this, and they put a large number of people in a room and offered them two choices. Choice number one to the different people. So one group of people got this question, and the other group of people got this question. And this choice here is sure gain of 500 euros or dollars, whatever, or 50% chance of winning $1,000. And in the second group, they ask, you know, what would you prefer, sure loss of $500 or 50% chance of losing $1,000? And in principle, what the theory said until that point was that whether it's a gain or a loss you're talking about, you should get the same results. You know, some people prefer something certain, some people prefer to take a risk, but it shouldn't matter whether it's a gain or a loss. You should get the same result. And when they did the experiment, they found these results. Here, 85% of the people prefer a sure gain of $500, and 70% of the people prefer to take a risk when you're talking about a loss. And it's quite interesting that there are actually some people explain this by evolution. You know, if you're a lion in the savannah, then it's better to get, you know, a small animal to eat. It's better to have something small to eat just today than trying to get a bigger lunch that could last 2 days, but that you can miss. So it's a better evolutionary strategy to go for the sure gain. Whereas it's a better evolutionary choice also to go to take a risk when it comes to a loss, you know, because it's better when you're just on the edge of starvation. It's better to get to make sure that you don't lose something big. That if you lose something, you lose something small, but you know that you lose it. And when you're trying to sell security, that's exactly what you're trying to do. You're in this position. You say, well, you know, sure loss of certain amount. You know, you pay for a QKD system today. It's a sure loss. But you reduce your risk of losing something more later. So if someone goes for encryption, security technology, whatever, antiviruses, firewalls, they have to make this choice. They have to make this choice to prefer a sure loss, but to take the risk of not losing something big later. And that's really a difficulty in selling security. Is that you face this, and that's something fundamental. So for a small company, it's for these three reasons, it's difficult to go to security to sell security products. Now, I'll just say also a few words about the cost of QKD, just so that you see a little bit what kind of cost we're talking about. And let's look at the encryption of one link in one case and four links in the other case, and compare the investment. And we'll look also at classical encryption, and we'll take as an example gigabit Ethernet, which is kind of standard in terms of bit rate. And so if you want to encrypt such a link, you need two encryptors and two QKD boxes, whereas if you want to encrypt four links, you need eight encryptors, but still two QKD boxes. And the cost here for the single link, so you need two encryptors, about $30,000, so that's 60. Two QKD system is about 100,000, so that's 160. And so you see that the quantum premium is fairly high. You more than double the price by adding quantum key distribution. So that's really a large investment. If you look at a case where you have more encryptors, now the encryption part is 240, and QKD remains 100,000. So you see now that the quantum premium is less than 50%. And so it's easier to sell quantum key distribution in a case where you have several encryptors or several links rather than one link. And so here, the solution, what we're trying to do is really to target the right applications. So we're trying to target more these kind of cases, typically data center to data center, than cases where there's a single link. Also, maybe for you guys, new developments should target also cost reduction. So far, I don't think really anyone has looked at making something very cheap, and that could be very useful. And also, We need to be able to use economies of scales when the market grow to reduce the cost of the technology of the products to reduce it. So that's one thing. That's the investment, what you must pay day one to start encrypting. Now I'll share with you a difficulty we have with a bank in Geneva, a bank which is using quantum cryptography today. Can't tell you the name of the bank, but I can tell you that there is one using quantum cryptography. And you know, banks, why would they encrypt and choose a certain solution? Their problem is not security, it's compliance. They need to prove to these regulation authorities that they comply with the different regulations. And so that's what counts for them. And so they need to do audits, and then there's an auditing company comes and checks everything. And one of the requirements they have is to have a disaster recovery site with the copy of the data so that if there is a big disaster, they can restart their operations. And currently, this is done in the Geneva area, 10, 15 kilometers, but it's increasing. Typically, in Switzerland, it should be of the order of 50 kilometers, and in the US, it's more 250 kilometers. I don't know about Canada, but the trend is that distance should increase. An example, typically, of what happened in Japan shows also, you know, if you have a zone of 60 kilometers that can be touched by radiation, that means, you know, you should be at least more than 60 kilometers, this kind of things. So now there's a trend to plan and build new backups data centers at increased distances. Problem is that, you know, we need a dark fiber for the quantum channel, and it's okay over 10 kilometers in terms of cost and availability, but much less over 50 kilometers. And one way to try to reduce, to solve this problem, is to do WDM, to use one fiber for classical channels and also quantum channel. So, you know, you could look at the spectrum, you could have different wavelengths in one fiber, some classical wavelengths, and then you take one of the wavelengths for the quantum channel. That would be nice if it were possible to do. The problem is that with QKD, when you filter out the other channels, at the end of the link, you'd like to filter out all the classical channels to get just the single photons. Classical filters tend to attenuate the classical channels, but the factor is not sufficient. It's typically maybe 20 dB, maybe 30 dB, but you have more than three orders of magnitude here. You have really, maybe 70 dB of difference. And so you really need very good filtering. You need to stack filters. If you stack filters, you get more attenuation, and so that's not good for QKD. The other difficulty is crosstalk due to Raman scattering, where you have inelastic scattering with photons changing wavelengths and overlapping with the quantum channel. And these you can't filter. You cannot, unfortunately, filter because they have the same wavelengths. And so QKD over WDM has been demonstrated. We've done tests with our system. Our system works with a dark fiber up to 50 or 100 kilometers, depending on the quality of the fiber. But with WDM, we're limited to 10 to 20 kilometers. And that's one of the difficulties. And so now if we go back to the example of this bank, they want to put their data center 50 kilometers away from Geneva. First of all, and now I'm going to talk about really problems that have nothing to do with physics, but have to do with the reality of the commercial environment. First of all, if you look for dark fiber over 50 kilometers, it's very difficult to find from the main telecom operators. They don't want to lease dark fiber because it's not, you know, it's not their business model. They want to sell service, not a fiber. Once you've offered a fiber, then there's nothing, the company can put whatever they want. So it's not interesting from a business perspective. So then you can go to second-tier telcos, for example, public utilities companies, which specialize in dark fiber, but these are not considered as credible suppliers for demanding customers. And also the costs are really relatively high. A telecom operator would expect for fiber over 50 kilometers something like $15 per month in terms of revenues, whereas just a classical channel is about $2,000 per month. So if you look now at the total cost of ownership of deploying QKD over 50 kilometers, the investment now that you're doing two QKD boxes, $100,000, but the dark fiber for 1 year, it's even more than the initial investment. And normally this kind of deployment is not done for 1 year, but for 5 years. So the total cost of ownership, which is what's important for a user, is really even higher than what comes out of the investment. So what can we do about this? First of all, I would encourage you guys to take market requirements into consideration when developing new systems. And there could be approaches, some optical systems that are more robust to WDM, to crosstalk and this kind of noise. And so that could be one motivation to develop new QKD protocols and approaches. The other thing what we're trying to do is to have a new business model where we mix several quantum channels on one optical fiber. So for example, you know, you have one city and a second city, and customers along this main axis could use one fiber, but then but share the fiber for the quantum channel. And so you could divide the price of the dark fiber by the number of customers, or even offer QKD as a service to the customers. And that's something we're trying to set up right now in Switzerland in collaboration with a telecom company. Now, getting to the end of my presentation, last thing I'd like to say is that quantum hacking is good. And I often get the question, you know, oh, Makarov is a bad guy. And I think it's the opposite. It's really important that people try to break quantum cryptography. Of course, when I first hear about it, I'm not happy, and it takes me a little bit of time to because again, I know that journalists will call me and ask me questions. But I think it's important. It's the only serious way to go ahead for quantum cryptography is to have people really look at practical security and measure, look for practical vulnerabilities and find countermeasures also to these vulnerabilities. And I think it's very important to have this kind of work. If it can be done in a, Vadim Makarov always talks about responsible disclosure, and I think it's the right approach. What his approach is to first talk to the group that has developed the QKD system, to tell them about the problem so that they can find a patch, a countermeasure, before publishing his work. And that's an approach taken from the classical security world. And I think that's a good approach, a reasonable approach. And if it's done like that, it's really good that people try to break QKD systems. I'd like to be clear on this. So that's I guess the end of my presentation. That's where we are now, you know, about 15, a bit more than 15 employees selling devices for scientific instrumentation, random number generators, and QKD. There's a market for QKD, but it's small. It's growing, but small. But it's still a very exciting experience. Also, when I look back, it's interesting that the group of Nicolas Gisin, you know, I told you at the beginning, had applied activities and more fundamental activities. And now when you talk to Nicolas, he's changed the activities. Now the applied activities, it's quantum cryptography. He considers this as applied. And more fundamental is quantum communication and quantum memories. So in 10 years, it went, in the view of Nicolas, from fundamental to applied. That's also something interesting. And now to conclude my presentation, I'd like to share a little bit why I liked the fact to be an entrepreneur, and why what I lacked in research. And when I finished my PhD in Geneva, I really thought that one of the things that is, there were two things that I was missing. I was missing multidisciplinary interactions, you know, to interact with people that do not only quantum optics, physics, but other things that are related to what you do. And also the fact that I thought that it was very, you work, you know, in small teams or sometimes also alone. And I missed that. And what I really like in working in a company is all the teamwork that you have. And sometimes it gets a bit difficult. And to illustrate this, I can show you a few slides. And that's an example of a new product development. You know, you have typically in a company, you have marketing that comes up with an idea and says, we need to build this kind of thing, you know, three level, and so they come with a product ID, and then the ID is passed to management, and management approves something which is related to what marketing proposes, but not exactly the same thing. Then it goes to R&D, and engineers have to actually design the product. And when you have something that has been developed, then you need to install it to manufacture it. So that's what manufacturing does, and then maintenance. Maintenance installs it in a certain way, and then at the end you find out what the customer really wanted. And I think that's something that I really enjoy, is to have to talk, to organize all these different functions in order to make sure that this is as close as possible to what you actually do in the company. And that's what motivates me in this job. Thank you for your attention, and if you have questions.